Hello friends, this video is on Hindu Marriage Act 1955 Part 2. In this we will include void and voidable marriages and about matrimonial remedies which are judicial separations and restitution of conjugal rights. Beginning to the first, that is void marriage, let us understand what actually void marriages are. Void marriages, according to Section 11 of Hindu Marriage Act, are any marriage solemnized after the commencement of this Act shall be null and void and may, on a petition presented by either party thereto against the other party, be so declared by a decree of nullity if it contravenes any one of the conditions specified in clauses 1, 4 and 5 of Section 5. Now, as we have already discussed in the previous video, what are the valid conditions for any marriage to be subsistent and come to existence? So, Section 5, Clause 1 talked about bigamy. Any person who do a bigamy, the second marriage will be a void ab initio. That means, void ab initio means that does not exist from its very beginning. Hence, any person who do second marriage when his first marriage was subsistent, then that person's second marriage will be void ab initio. Then Section 5, Clause 4 and 5 talks about sependa and prohibited degree of relationship. So if any person married to his or her sependa or to a person who is within their prohibited degree of relationship, then again that marriage will be declared void ab initio. Also, there's one more condition which is not specifically mentioned in Section 11, that is essential ceremonies. If essential ceremonies are not performed in that particular marriage, then that marriage will again be declared void. Okay, so these are the conditions or these are the grounds on which any Hindu marriage can be declared as void. Moving on to the voidable marriage. Now, what actually voidable marriage is? Voidable marriage is a marriage which can be annulled by a decree of court on petition of either party. Parties cannot marry second time unless dissolution of first marriage. Now, voidable marriages are perfectly valid marriage as long as it is not avoided. As long as it is not avoided, all legal consequences subsist. Decree is given retrospective effect from the date of the marriage, and hence if it becomes voidable and one person claims in the court to declare it void, hence then it will become void ab initio, and if neither party go to the court for its to avoid the marriage, then it will be a perfectly valid marriage. Now, voidable marriages are described in Section 12 of Hindu Marriage Act. So according to it, first, clause 1, any marriage solemnized, whether before or after the commencement of this act, shall be voidable and may be annulled by a decree of nullity or any of the following grounds, namely. So, the marriage, any marriage which is voidable before or after the commencement of that act is a perfectly valid marriage until either party of the marriage pass a decree of nullity on grounds mentioned in Section 12. Now, before coming to the grounds mentioned in Section 12, Section 16 of Hindu Marriage Act, children of void and voidable marriages to be considered as legitimate children, and wife of void marriages cannot claim maintenance. Under Section 125 of CRPC, a wife of voidable marriage can. So, a wife of a void marriage, or when a marriage is declared void, cannot claim maintenance, but if it is voidable marriage, then the wife can claim maintenance, and the children of both void as well as voidable marriages will be considered as a legitimate child. Now, coming to the grounds of Section 12, there are basically four grounds mentioned in Section 12 for a marriage to be declared voidable. First is impotency. Second is incapacity to consent or mental disorder. Third is consent by fraud or force. And fourth is pre-marriage pregnancy. Now, first come to the impotency concept, that is given in Section 12, Clause A. Section 12, Clause 1, Sub-Clause A. That is that the marriage has not been consummated owing to the impotency of the respondent. Now, Impotency is the incapability to consummate marriage on account of impotency. It can be a mental as well as physical. This can be better understood from a case of Nijhawan versus Nijhawan. It is a 1973 case where wife felt depressed owing to failure of husbands to perform marital intercourse. Where the court held that husband's impotency cause of cruelty to a wife as a harmonious sexual activity is foundation of marriage. Also, there was a case of Shivanti versus Bhora, 1971's case, where husband alleged that wife was impotent. However, it was found that wife was barren but was capable of marital intercourse. It was held that mere barrenness or incapacity to conceive a child does not amount to impotency. Hence, impotency is merely a incapacity to do a intercourse concept. Now, the burden of proof in impotency is on the petitioner, whoever files the petition for to declare the marriage void has to prove that the partner of his or her is impotent. Now, coming to the next, that is incapacity to consent or mental disorder. Hindu Marriage Act 1955 stipulates that the consent should be free of a valid marriage. Hence, there should be a free consent for a valid marriage. So, incapability to give consent due to insanity or mental disorder will make the marriage voidable. This we have already discussed in Section 5, Clause 2. Now, mere mental weakness or excessive sentimental nature not contemplate in this. Now, if a person is emotionally weak, doesn't mean that that person is incapable for consent. Also, actual evidence of insanity or regular or frequent basis can be concluded as insanity because it's hard to prove someone's mental status. So, their daily evidences and regular and frequent basis acts can be a evidence to conclude person to be insane. Now, as we have done a case of Alka versus Abhinesh, in this case, wife was not actually responsible for the marriage and she was very careless about all the stuffs, and it was proved that she was suffering from schizophrenia. So court held that it is a mental disorder and she was incapable for the consent and hence declared the marriage voidable. Now, coming to the next, consent by fraud or force. Now, this is given in Section 12, Clause C, that the consent of the petitioner or where the consent of the guardian in marriage of the petitioner was required under Section 5, as it stirs immediately before the commencement of the Child Marriage Restraint Amendment Act 1978, the consent of such guardian was obtained by force or by fraud, as the nature of the ceremony or as to any material fact or circumstances concerning the respondent, that marriage can be declared as a voidable marriage. Now, consent obtained by fraud or force. Petition within 1 year of discovery of fraud or cessation of force can file the case. If petition files the case after 1 year of discovery of fraud or cessation of force, then that marriage is no more voidable and will be a valid marriage, and then that suit won't be subsistent. Petitioner must not have voluntarily cohabited with spouse after such discovery cessation, and also force and coercion and under influence might be the cause of that fraud or force. And fraud, misrepresentation or concealment of facts regarding the nature of ceremony or any material fact or circumstances that might concern the respondent. Now here what we are actually talking about fraud and force that might cause due to concealment of some facts. That concealment of fact must be related to the nature of ceremony or any material fact or any circumstances that might concern the respondent about it. Like in the case of Harbhajan versus Brijbala, father of girl promised groom that his daughter is virgin, which he figured after the marriage that she was not, and then sued his father-in-law for doing a fraud. But court held that this was not a fact which concealment should affect the consent of the respondent, and held there was no fraud about it, as it was as well not intentional. And also, these are the ऑर्थोडॉक्स मेंटालिटी ऑफ द पीपल विच मे नॉट बी मोटिवेटेड बाय द कोर्ट्स. देन केम नंद किशोर वर्सेज श्रीमती मुन्नीबाई केस 1979 वेयर कोर्ट वॉज हेल्ड कोर्ट हेल्ड दैट द फ्रॉड अंडर हिंदू मैरिज एक्ट 1955 डज नॉट हैव सेम मीनिंग एज अंडर द इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट. नाउ इन इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट द फ्रॉड विच अकर्स लीड्स टू द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एज मैरिज इज नॉट अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. हियर द फ्रॉड वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट इज नॉट सिमिलर टू दैट फ्रॉड ऑफ इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट. कमिंग टू द नेक्स्ट फोर्थ ग्राउंड दैट इज प्री मैरिज प्रेगनेंसी. प्री मैरिज प्रेगनेंसी नाउ it is given in section 12 clause d that the respondent was at the time of marriage pregnant by some other than the petitioner. Now respondent pregnant at the time of marriage and pregnant from other than the petitioner. Petitioner was not aware of such pregnancy at the time of marriage and petition was within the 1 year of marriage. No marital intercourse with the consent of petitioner after knowing of such pregnancy. These are the few essentials of pre-marriage pregnancy, that the respondent might be pregnant at that time of marriage and pregnant from other person. Petitioner was not aware of that and this petition was filed within the 1 year of marriage. And the burden of proof to prove that the petitioner is right is on the petitioner as himself. So here we done with the grounds of voidable marriage. Now let's moving towards the matrimonial remedies. There are two matrimonial remedies, that is restitution of conjugal rights and judicial separation. Now the Hindu Marriage Act 1955 embodies different remedies for redressal of grievances of the aggrieved spouse. As the name suggests, such remedies are available to the parties who have entered into a valid Hindu marriage in accordance to the Hindu Marriage Act 1955. Also the ensuring slides discuss different matrimonial remedies available to the parties to a valid Hindu marriage. So beginning to the first, that is given in section 9, that is restitution of conjugal rights. So restitution of conjugal rights concept originated from a Jewish law, and here conjugal rights, by conjugal rights we means matrimonial rights. Example like comfort and company of spouse, that all the things we include in a conjugal right, that the both the rights parties are bound to follow and they have their duties as well as right towards it. It is a positive relief aiming to preserve marriage. Necessary implications of marriage, that is the cohabitation. It focuses on the cohabitation concept. Now reading to the section 9, that is restitution of conjugal rights, that is when either the husband or the wife has without reasonable excuse withdrawn from the society of the other, the aggrieved party may apply by petition to the district court or restitution of conjugal rights, and the court, on being satisfied to the truth of the statement made in such petition and there is no legal ground why the application should not be granted, may decree of restitution of conjugal rights accordingly. Now reading to the explanation, I'll explain it further on. Explanation given on section 9 is where a question arises whether there has been a reasonable excuse for withdrawal from the society. The burden of proving reasonable excuse shall be on the person who has withdrawn from the society. So according to section 9, the burden of proof that the reasonable excuse is for that the avoidance of cohabitation, the burden of proof is on the party who has withdrawn from the society. Now for restitution of conjugal rights, the respondent must have withdrawn from the society of the petitioner. Second, there might not be any reasonable cause. That withdrawal of from the society must have been followed without any reasonable cause, and court satisfied about the truth of the statement in the petition. And there is no legal ground that court shall refuse that decree of restitution of conjugal rights. So if court is satisfied with all these essentials, then it will pass the decree of restitution of conjugal rights. Now what actually will be the effect of restitution of conjugal rights? According to it, the party who has withdrawn from the society within the reasonable time must come back to the person and live and start cohabiting together. Withdrawal from the society here has an element of desertion. Desertion is a ground of divorce under Section 13 of Hindu Marriage Act, which we will do further, but it has been contemplated to be a lesser intensity as compared to the meaning of desertion as recognized in Hindu Marriage Act. Also, withdrawal from society implies both total repudiation of cohabitation. Total repudiation of cohabitation, it is a voluntary act of refusing to cohabit, no seeing, no talks, no talking terms, nothing. It's a total cohabitation and total separation. Reasonable cause refers to any ground of, and here reasonable cause we are talking about refers to any ground of matrimonial relief or such situation which make it impossible to cohabit if it is a result, weighty and grave act or omission. Now, in a case like Jayendra versus Shivacharan, which is a Jammu and Kashmir's case, 1965, husband's persistent that wife must live with his parents. So court held it to be reasonable for wife to withdraw from the society of the husband. As husband's persistence to wife to live with his parents lead wife to withdraw from the society, and it is the wife's reasonable cause for withdrawing from the society of the husband, and hence the degree of restitution of conjugal rights was not passed. Then also when it comes to the burden of proof and effect of degree, burden of proof is initially on the plaintiff and it passed subsequently on the respondent to prove reasonable cause. Now when it comes to the effect of degree of restitution, non-compliance enables the spouse to obtain divorce after the lapse of 1 year. But such petition should have been initiated with sincere desire to resume cohabitation. Now, actually, there are the cases like Sushil Kumar versus Prem Kumar, where husband and wife withdrawal from the society of the husband. Then husband went to the court for a decree of restitution of conjugal right. Later, after few days, again he went to the court asking for a decree of divorce as wife is having some other relation and she is not coming back. Even husband didn't pay any effort to bring the wife back to his house. So court held that there shall be some sincere desire to resume that cohabitation, and court will not help people to fulfill their unreasonable desires or to get divorced and use this degree of restitution conjugal rights as their selfish motives. So that compliance of restitution of degree, court gave a time of 1 year lapse before obtaining the degree of divorce. Now, restitution of conjugal degrees had been a drawback for the working ladies. Like, can a wife choose to live separately due to her employment? So there was a question that many of the times wife and husband has to live separate because of the employment purposes, because one may have job somewhere else and one may have job somewhere else. So initially there was an approach of a conservative by the courts, where like in case of Tirath Kaur versus Kirpal Singh and Gaya Prasad versus Bhagwati are one of those cases in my notice, where court held that it is not a sufficient excuse for a wife, and right to cohabit by husband is a dominant incident of marriage and wife should quit his job and come back and cohabit by the husband. Obligation of wife to cohabit is clear and unequivocal according to court, and hence wife was asked to come back to home of the husband and live with him. So this was a conservative approach used by the court, as it is a case of 1975 and 1966. Later in 1978 came a Swaraj Garg versus K.M. Garg case, where court approached a progressive view and held that no warrant in Hindu law that choice of matrimonial home is exclusive privilege of husband. If financially better, not always should wife resign. So like, why should wife always resign to cohabit with the husband and fulfill their conjugal rights? It can also be the husband who can resign his job and come back. So if he came with the conditions to make it more easier, like if both are financially better, then it's not always important that wife should resign. And if both are equally balanced situation, neither can sue for restitution of conjugal rights
एंड इट मे लीड टू अ ब्रेक डाउन ऑफ मैरिज, बट वी कांट फोर्स वाइफ टू क्विट हिज जॉब हर जॉब. ऑल्सो कम्स अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैलिडिटी ऑफ सेक्शन 9. कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैलिडिटी, देर इज अ केस ऑफ टी सरिता वर्सेज टी वी सुब्बैया, विद सेक्शन 9 एलिज्ड टू बी इन वॉयलेशन ऑफ आर्टिकल 21 ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन. And it was held that Section 9 is an unconstitutional as the grossest form of violation. Like, it held that it is a violation of your right to life and liberty, that you can't live your life according to yourself. If you don't want to live with your spouse, the court is forcing you to come to live with him according to the with degree of restitution of conjugal right, which court held it's completely unconstitutional as the grossest form of violation. Then came Harvinder Kaur versus Harminder Singh case, where wife challenged a decree of restitution granted to her husband by the lower court. The court, while dismissing the plea, held that the section was constitutionally valid. Then came Saroj Rani versus Sudarshan Kumar case in 1984 as well, where the wife petitioned for restitution of conjugal rights after being turned out from the house. Now, court held that section 9 is constitutional, and its purpose is to offer inducement for the husband or wife to live together and to settle their differences amicably. So there is no wrong motive of the constitution or the section 9, and it is completely constitutional. Then came law commission in its consultation paper on reform of family law in August 2018 reaffirmed the need of deletion of section 9, saying that in the current context, when the number of women are as educated as men are and are contributing to other family incomes, the provision of restitution of conjugal rights should not be permitted to take away these hard-earned freedoms. So this was a mere recommendation by Law Commission in August 28th. So this is all the concept of restitution of conjugal rights, and at the current status, restitution of conjugal rights is totally constitutionally valid. Now, moving on to the next section, that is section 10, that is a judicial separation. Now, judicial separation, by the word, it is clear that through judicially you lives in a separate homes or get separated. Now, it is a lesser evil than divorce, like it does not dissolve marriage, but parties are not bound to cohabit. Mere suspension of marital rights and duties, and it is not for absolutely, but it's just for a time period according to court. During subsistence of judicial separation, parties are not free to remarry, both husband and wife. Now, after 1976 amendment of Hindu Marriage Act, grounds for judicial separations merged with that of the divorce. So discretionary power of courts to grant judicial separation instead of divorce in a petition for divorce. Now, before, the grounds for judicial separation was different than the grounds for divorce. But after 1976 Amendment Act, the grounds for divorce and judicial separation are merged and are the same. So whenever a person go for a decree of divorce and a court think that there are some chances that person may preserve their marriage, then it can grant a decree of judicial separation for a period of time. Now, according to Section 13 of divorce, it is a ground for both husband and wife, and there are some special grounds for wife specially. So, decree of judicial separation can be rescinded on application of either party after the court is satisfied by the honesty of the statement and seems just and reasonable. Now, there is a difference between judicial separation and divorce. Like, coming to the first, that is rescission. Decree of judicial separation can be rescinded, but decree of divorce cannot be rescinded. Like, in a judicial separation, after judicial separation, if parties think now they are ready to cohabit together and start a new beginning life, then they can rescind it, cancel the decree of judicial separation, and can live a new life. But decree of divorce cannot be cancelled, and to again cohabit together, they need to remarry. Now, succession, and then second is the succession to property. In case of death of one spouse during the subsistence of decree of judicial separation, the other spouse inherits the property of the deceased spouse. But in a decree of divorce, spouse has no right of inheritance on the assets of deceased spouse. Okay, so this is very clear on the succession to property. Then third is reconciliation. In judicial separation, marriage is only eclipsed for a while, so scope of reconciliation. There is a scope of reconciliation, but in case of divorce, there is no scope of reconciliation without a marriage ceremony that we have done earlier, like it's same like a rescission. Also, in judicial separation, if during the subsistence of decree, parties indulge in marital intercourse, the decree is rendered ineffective automatically. But in case of divorce, such intercourse has no effect on the decree. So here we are done with the judicial separation and its difference with divorce, and also with the restitution of conjugal rights, void and voidable marriage. Now in my next video, I'll talk about dissolution of marriage, and we will be done with the concept of Hindu Marriage Act 1955. Thank you.